Sheldon with you.
Thank you, Tom. Good evening, candidates. Let's talk about sales and income taxes. You all have differing views on whether New Hampshire should have one. Ms. Cilley, let's start with you on this. You say we need to have a grown-up conversation when it comes to this topic. Sounds a little non-committal. Do you or do you not believe New Hampshire needs a broad-based tax?
Well, first of all, if you're asking about the pledge to not discount anything, that's a separate conversation. I've said pledges are ways to shut down conversations, and pledges are a way to not govern. But in terms of the revenue streams that we need, first of all, we ought to start on the other side of the balance sheet. What's our vision? What do we want this state to look like 5 years from now, 10 years from now? I know what my goals are. They're pretty simple, and they're what businesses need. Education, good roads, good bridges, good communication infrastructure, and a safe, healthy communities. So once you establish those priorities and you determine whether they can be provided in the way that we already resource government with existing revenue streams, then you can also look at other options that may take the burden off from our property taxes, you know, property taxpayers, which I've heard an awful lot about as I've gone around the state, as well as our business profits tax. I don't disagree with some of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle that say that should come down, but you have to do that and maintain your priorities.
So that sounds like a we'll see.
I think that everything is on the table.
Okay. Ms. Hassan, we'll get to you in just a second, but your primary opponent recently released an ad on this topic specific to the pledge. Let's see a little bit of that.
This no tax pledge is turning our politicians into pledge zombies, all doing the same thing, not listening to anyone, and don't even try having a conversation with them.
Okay, so let's get this out of the way, Ms. Hassan. Are you a zombie?
Look, I think voters need to know where candidates stand on issues that are really important to them. I think they demand it, particularly when you've seen the bait and switch that this current legislature did after the 2010 elections. I have knocked on literally thousands of doors in five state Senate campaigns, talked with New Hampshire voters, grown-ups, about this issue, and they share my concern about the impact of a sales or income tax on our economy and our families. I oppose a sales or income tax, and I would veto one if it came to my desk. And I think it's very, very important that we be clear on this issue, just as we would be clear on many of the other issues that voters ask us about, whether it's our position on choice or the environment or working men and women's rights. I think it's really important that we fund our priorities without an income or sales tax. I've done it in the past, and we can do it again.
Mr. Kennedy, you've been very clear on this issue. You support an income tax in New Hampshire. Why?
I do, and it's because of the regressive property taxes. Our property taxes are double the national average. To me, I'm incensed by that fact. Our forefathers talked about fair, share. They talked about equitable rule. They talked about proportionate to income. At no time did they say that we had to use an antiquated pledge to drop all consideration of other revenue sources. So once again, it's about being rational, about being reasonable, about being right, and to do what's right. And the regressive taxes, by the way, sales tax is also a regressive tax because it affects the people that can afford it the least. So I'm not a big proponent of sales tax either. But property tax is very regressive and disproportionate payments based on income. For instance, the poor pay 8 to 10% in relation to their income, middle class 4 to 6. And then the rich, and I've got nothing against the rich. Everybody aspires to be better off, but they pay less than 2% in proportion to their income.
John DeSasso, you have a question for Ms. Hassan.
Yes, Ms. Hassan, staying on the same topic. In 2002, running for the state Senate, you said you would vote for, quote, the right income tax. You did happen to lose that particular election. And since then, as you said, including this campaign, you've pledged to veto sales or income tax because you say you've learned that most people in the state oppose it. One might say that this might be a politically motivated decision or stance. How do you personally feel in your heart about the need in this state to have a sales or income tax?
Well, I didn't support an income or sales tax in 2002, although I didn't take the pledge. Since that time, as I said, I have knocked on thousands and thousands of doors in state Senate campaigns, talked with voters who are really thoughtful about this issue, and learned from them about how important it is to them, as well as to our economy and our middle-class families, that we solve our problems, fund our priorities without an income or sales tax. I've come to learn how important it is to our economy. We have an economy structured around not having an income or sales tax. We have middle-class families who haven't had a raise in years while their costs keep going up. And I think it's incumbent on us to make sure that we look to our current revenue structure to fund our priorities, and we can do that.
Accurate to say that speaking to the voters then prompted you to change your view?
No, I don't think I changed my view. I didn't take the pledge in 2002.
Thank you.
Josh Rogers for Jackie Cilley.
Mrs. Cilley, you've said we need an adult conversation about how we're going to fund state priorities. You could be governor in 4 months and will be expected to bring specific ideas to the table. Why not have some of the conversation tonight? How much revenue do you think the state will need to raise to meet your priorities? And will an income or sales tax be part of your thinking?
Josh, first of all, as I said, we start on the one side of the balance sheet with what those priorities are, what revenue streams we currently have, where we can get efficiencies out of government. I know that that's been, you know, tried in the past. We've gotten, I think, Governor Lynch did a very good job of doing that. I think that there are others that we can find. I've mentioned along the trail, for example, we have, you know, some of the top paid department heads coming in every other Wednesday asking for $5,000 grants. So there are ways we get the efficiencies, and then we look at maximizing the use of all of our revenues today and overlay that with, are there other options that can more fairly distribute the responsibility for resourcing government appropriately. That's a process. That's not something that happens overnight. And by the way, a governor works with 424 legislators to do that.
Josh, I'm sorry, do you have a follow-up for that?
Well, I was going to ask Mr. Kennedy about the math of your proposal. I mean, have you looked at what your plan would raise and what it would do to state revenue? And you say you want it to reduce property taxes. How can you guarantee that an income tax would offset local property taxes, since that's handled at the local level?
I'm glad you asked that, Josh, because everybody does. When you collect an income tax, part of that will be dedicated to education. Currently, the municipalities are saddled with the preponderance of the burden of education. That has to go back to the state, as the Supreme Court ruled. I believe it's a state responsibility. Once the state collects revenue and pushes it back to the communities, that should have a corresponding reduction in their taxes related to education. So I can't guarantee, but there's ways that we can put in referendums. There's ways that we can try to change the Constitution. I'm not about changing Constitution, because I think the way it's orchestrated, currently articulated, is adequate. We just need to live by it, and we need to be fair, equitable, and proportionate.